Hello, and welcome to the third annual Calgary Climate Symposium. My name is Dick Eberson, and I'm the manager for climate change and environment with the City of Calgary's climate program. In the spirit of reconciliation, I'd like to echo the land acknowledgement from our opening event and recognize that we are broadcasting from the traditional territories of the people of Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta. The City of Calgary is also homeland to the historic Northwest Métis and to Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. We acknowledge all Indigenous urban Calgarians who have made Calgary their home. For today's session, we are using the Microsoft Teams live event platform, and the entire session is being recorded. You can access the recording with your link for 30 days. Recordings will also be posted to calgary.ca/climatesymposium in the coming weeks. As members of the audience, you will not be able to share your audio or video. However, you can interact with myself and the presenters using the Q&A button. The Q&A button looks like two overlapping speech bubbles with a question mark in it. Let's have a look at the agenda for today. Following a few open remarks from me, I will hand it over to Binnu, Jeyakumar, Director, Clean Energy, Pembina Institute for Alberta's Emerging for Alberta's Emerging Economy, a Blueprint for Job Creation by 2030. That's a really interesting topic, Binnu, by the way. Looking forward to that. There will be a chance for questions at the end of today's presentation. We will endeavor to answer all of your questions either in the Q&A or by asking the speaker herself. We apologize in advance if we are not able to get to your question, as sometimes the Q&A can be very active. On that note, I would also like to recognize Adrienne Beatty, the communications strategist with the climate program. She's working behind the scenes to post announcements, links to resources, and answering questions in the Q&A. As a little side note, Adrienne has also been the person to push out all our communications with regards to this climate symposium, and I think we can all give her a hand to say how successful this has been. Thank you so much, Adrienne. Really appreciate this. I invite you to join the discussion about climate change and this event on social media using the hashtag YYC Climate Symposium. Before handing it over to Binnu, I would like to take a moment to recognize all the partners in the community who helped to spread the word about the Climate Symposium, offer to host sessions, and or put on satellite events throughout this week. Now, I'd like to thank Binnu for joining us today to contribute her expertise. Binnu brings a wealth of skills, expertise, and experience from the power industry, government, and nonprofit sectors to her position as Director of Clean Energy Program of the Pembina Institute, Canada's leading energy think tank. Her portfolio includes managing the phase out of coal power, integrating renewables, and modernizing the grid. She has expertise in fossil fuel and renewable generation technologies, community energy, sustainability strategy development, and so forth. She has designed and convened several multi-stakeholder engagement on energy policy issues. Before joining the Pembina Institute, Binnu worked as a plant and performance engineer at TransAlta's various generating facilities in Alberta, Ontario, and Mexico. She also provided management consulting services to the Ghanaian government, focusing on local government effectiveness. She currently serves on the board of Blue Green Canada. Today's presentation will be approximately 30 to 45 minutes with a Q&A. I'll finish with some closing remarks at the very end. Please post your questions to the Q&A throughout the presentation, and we will gather them to ask on your behalf. Welcome, Binnu. I will invite you now to unmute your mic and turn on your video. We would love to hear what you have to say today. Over to you.
Great. Thank you very much, Dick, for having me at the symposium. Can you confirm if you can see my screen?
Yes, I can.
Great. Amazing. It sounds like it's been a very interesting discussion so far at the symposium, very timely and very important also around the various parts of the energy transition and climate action. Really glad to see this happening in our city. And with this session, I hope to add another layer to that discussion around job opportunities that can come as we take climate action and diversify the economy. So just before I begin, for those of you who don't know the Pembina Institute, we are a nonprofit think tank. Our mission is to ensure that there is a prosperous and clean energy future for Canada. And we try to do that through credible policy solutions that support communities, support a thriving economy, and works towards a safe climate. As Dick mentioned, and as probably you've heard in the rest of the symposium, this is a very timely discussion to be having, particularly as we are rebuilding after the pandemic. There's a lot of opportunities at our door as we come out of it. I know there's also been a lot of job losses. It's not an easy conversation to have, and caveat for my presentation, I don't have all the answers. I do think there are very exciting opportunities in front of us, and there's a bit of a difficult path to navigate there. And we're not alone. This is something all countries are doing as they come out of the pandemic. And a lot of folks are actually building momentum around a net zero economy as part of their COVID recovery. We're actually seeing support for net zero commitments and plans for it across over 126 countries in the world. And I'd say it's not just governments, companies too, like oil and gas companies in Alberta, like Cenovus, CNRL, utilities like TransAlta and Capital Power, banks like the TD Bank of Canada, all have net zero commitments. So there is a real momentum for this. And I lastly want to say it's not just these actors, even citizens. So there was a survey done recently in Alberta, and we found that 2/3 of Albertans actually support driving towards a net zero economy. So that's great momentum. And now what does that mean for us? And that's what I want to explore in this session, particularly in terms of jobs that can be created in Alberta. And as I explore the different sectors, I also want to look at what are things we can do proactively to make sure that these sectors grow rapidly and that the jobs are created in an equitable manner that is accessible. And then in the discussion, I really want to get into maybe some of the tough questions around equity and wide participation in this market. So hoping for some input from folks as we get towards the end of the presentation. Just want to reiterate what Dick said. As we go through these slides, please pop your questions into the Q&A chat function there. I won't have all the answers, but really looking forward to the discussion. One final caveat before we go into the analysis. So the numbers I'm going to present here are based on an analysis that the Pembina Institute did in 2020, and we looked at direct jobs that are being created in the energy sector in Alberta. And so I just wanted to distinguish that between other types of jobs that are often reported when you'll hear about pipeline or transit projects. So direct jobs are jobs that are created to deliver the actual project or product. There's indirect jobs, which are supply chain jobs happening upstream of the project you're talking about, but they also contribute to that project. And then there's induced jobs, which looks at the broader economy, and that depends on wages that workers earn through their direct and indirect jobs, and depending on where they choose to spend their wages, it creates jobs in other sectors. So there's those three different kinds, but in our analysis, we're going to be focusing on the direct jobs. We looked at four major sectors in Alberta: renewable electricity, transit and electric vehicle infrastructure, energy efficiency in buildings and industry, and the oil and gas sector. I know, yes, the oil and gas sector does have some sustainable jobs, and I'll get to that. But I wanted to point out something here. So we chose these sectors because, first, they are energy sectors, which is the major driver of Alberta's economy right now. They also use technologies that are already commercially available and are being deployed at scale. So these are jobs that can be created today. We don't have to wait for a technological miracle or for technologies to become commercially available to create these jobs. But this is a reason we've left out a couple of sectors. And if I were to do that analysis again next year, I would probably include these sectors. And that includes hydrogen, which is where the province is starting to invest a lot, and carbon capture. Another big piece that's missing from this pie is non-energy jobs. So as we rebuild our economy, there's obviously jobs in other sectors, including the care economy. And just want to note that that's not captured here. We've focused only on the energy jobs. And so what we predicted here are about 67,000 jobs to be generated in these four sectors between now and 2030. And I'd say that is at the low end of the jobs potential spectrum, because we tried to stick to conservative scenarios in terms of how fast these sectors can grow. And in most cases, we actually expect them to grow much faster than what we have modeled. So I want to start with renewable energy, which is the fastest growing sector in many energy driven economies. In fact, actually, in the U.S., the labor market analysis showed that it's also the fastest job generator in the U.S. coming up in the next decade. So why is it growing this fast? There's sort of four main drivers. One is that renewables are cheap. They are the cheapest source of energy right now, other than energy efficiency. And just to give you a sense of how fast things are changing, by 2030, new wind and solar will be cheaper than operating existing coal plants. So that's a huge transformation that's going to be happening in our electricity sector. This graph here shows you what has happened already. So the orange bars there are projects that the Alberta government procured a couple of years ago. They're wind and solar projects. And you can see their costs are much lower than the average cost of a gas plant or a coal plant with CCS. So this is why you're seeing in many markets renewables outbidding and outcompeting fossil fuels. So that's a major driver of their growth. The other is also countries are starting to recognize the health impacts of pollution, particularly from coal plants. In Alberta, for example, it was costing us $461 million a year in socioeconomic costs because of the health impacts from coal pollution. Then there is climate policy. So I talked about net zero targets, but there's policies even in the electricity sector. The U.S. has set a target of 100% clean electricity by 2035. That's ambitious and very doable in an affordable manner. In Canada, we have a goal of 90% clean by 2030. And in Alberta, we have a goal of 30% renewables by 2030. I'm pretty confident we're going to meet that 30% target, and we actually could be much more ambitious. The last one I want to talk about is corporate procurement. So because of their low costs of renewables and increased attention that companies are paying to their ESG targets, there's a lot of companies like Starbucks, Maple Leaf Food, that are starting to buy renewable energy and enter into contracts with developers. And that's helping develop more renewable projects in the country. The Business Renewables Center of Canada, for example, anticipates over 2 gigawatts of corporate purchases of renewables by 2025. So that's just in the next 5 years. Okay, the growth is great. So what does this mean for jobs? We did some analysis using some of the scenarios that the Alberta Electric System Operator put out in their long-term outlook. And I'd say actually these scenarios might also be exceeded. So just give you a sense, like wind is at about 11% of our current generating capacity. Solar is 0.6%, changing almost every month. And so you can see the numbers here, how the different growth that we anticipate under different scenarios. And the jobs that could be created would be anywhere between 9,000 and 31,000 jobs. And that's because of it depends on how fast we grow these sectors. The one thing I want to bring to attention here is the numbers in the parentheses. So the jobs I mentioned here are direct jobs based on constructing wind farms and solar projects and maintaining them. But if we had some clear policy signals here in Alberta, we could actually attract the manufacturing industry. If they have faith that Alberta is going to continue to grow its renewable industry over the next few decades, we could actually manufacture wind turbine parts, for example, here in Alberta. And so that's what the parentheses show, is the number of jobs that can be created if we actually had a manufacturing sector related to our renewables here in Alberta. There's also things the city can do, and any municipality can do, to support this growth of clean electricity in the province. Something really direct is to actually own renewable energy projects or co-own them with renewable energy developers. There's solar rebate programs that can be rolled out that make it easier for folks to install solar panels and obviously then create jobs for solar installers. And there's actually many cities in Alberta that are already doing this. There's City of Edmonton, Lethbridge, Medicine Hat, Town of Banff, Canmore. There's more and more cities that are taking advantage of that. And similar to a rebate, there's also financing tools that can be deployed that make it easier for homeowners to install solar on their rooftop. The next sector I want to talk about is transportation. It is the third largest source of greenhouse gas emissions in Alberta. And in Calgary, it accounts for about a third of the city's emissions. And this is why many countries are actually taking action on transport, and you know, the action, there's a wide range of actions, and including even phasing out gasoline cars and incentivizing electric vehicles. When we looked at the jobs, we looked at jobs that can be created by investing in transit infrastructure projects and electric vehicle infrastructure projects. So already it leaves out a lot of other jobs that could be created in Alberta, you know, for example, with battery manufacturing, that could happen in Alberta. But looking at these two types of jobs, what we found was, yeah, there's obviously a lot of jobs out there for maintenance and construction of transit infrastructure, but also almost an equivalent amount for EV infrastructure. And what we found was actually public charging stations for electric vehicles can actually create more jobs than private ones, because they often tend to be more complex, they serve more purposes, they often get more usage, and that also creates more jobs. So that's the potential there. There's one thing that is hard to quantify, and perhaps you've heard it in some other transport presentations in the symposium, but it's that transit also creates access to jobs. So it allows people to access jobs that perhaps they wouldn't have been able to get to. And that includes through urban transit, but also through rural transit networks and transit networks that connect rural communities to urban centers. It just allows people to access a wider range of jobs and to be able to get to their jobs in more accessible ways. Some of the things that municipalities can do for taking advantage of these job opportunities in the transport sector is electrifying municipal fleet. So that's something very directly that a city can take action on. So for example, and Dick, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the city of Calgary has about 4,000 vehicles. So that's a huge fleet that could be turned over. And this doesn't only have to include cars and SUVs. The city of Calgary is actually piloting with two compressed natural gas garbage trucks and an electric garbage truck. Then there are cities who have deployed these kind of vehicles at large. There's also municipal bylaws that can be passed. This is an increasing thing in Calgary, particularly under renters. If you're buying an EV, where do you charge your car? And so having bylaws that incentivize or encourage buildings to be EV charger ready can help address some of those issues. Then there's a huge topic of decarbonizing freight in urban areas. And my colleagues actually presented on this just in over the last hour. So I hope you caught that. But there is a huge opportunity there in terms of transitioning all sorts of freight modes, you know, from fresh produce, all the Uber deliveries we're seeing right now, parcel deliveries, and then also, you know, snow cleaning and garbage trucks. There's a huge opportunity there. The next one I wanted to talk about is energy efficiency, which I also think the symposium has done a really good job of covering, and for a good reason. Like, energy efficiency is the cheapest way to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and it saves us on utility bills. From a job perspective, we looked at commercial and residential buildings, as well as industrial processes. And what we found was, as you start introducing new building standards and require upgrades to existing infrastructure, that creates jobs of different kinds, including trades, as well as professional professional jobs for assessments and design of new solutions. So there's job generation opportunities around there in the city, but there's also a lot of potential in industry to reduce the emissions and the energy use in their industrial processes. And again, that includes a lot of solutions to be created around technical solutions, process-based solutions, and a lot of those jobs can actually exist in Calgary downtown. And what can the city do around that? Again, I think this might have been covered better in other presentations, but just a quick overview. You know, building stock doesn't turn over as quickly as cars do. And that's a good thing. Buildings last for a long time. So one of the best things you can do is actually retrofit buildings to become more energy efficient. And there's a need for a lot of demonstration and pilot projects so people can see what a retrofit looks like and how it actually improves the building. And that's where the city can actually have its own pilot projects on city buildings, or even with accessible housing and affordable housing that the city might be supporting. There's opportunities to do that type of work in those buildings and showcase progress there. There's also incentives that could be provided or requirements for upgrades during special trigger events in a building. So, you know, things like sale of a building, major renovations that might be happening, or refinancing. At that time, you could have a permitting process that either mandates or incentivizes retrofits and upgrades. And then there's also net zero building targets and strategies that the city could do. The last one I wanted to talk about was oil and gas. So as we work to reducing the environmental impact of our oil and gas sector, not just for the environment, but also to be able to become competitive with oil and gas from other countries in this global market, there's a lot of opportunity to create jobs right here in Alberta. And we looked at two types of jobs, reclamation and in methane reduction. So for example, in Alberta, we've got about 336,000 wells. And about half of them are inactive or abandoned. So there's a lot of reclamation work that can be done there. And our oil and gas operations also leak a lot of methane. So that's a gas that is 84 times more potent than carbon dioxide. And we actually have a target of reducing methane emissions by 45% by 2025. And this is, again, like energy efficiency, a win-win-win situation. Reducing emissions from methane is the lowest cost method for lowering GHG emissions in the oil and gas sector. It also saves oil and gas companies money because you are wasting less natural gas to the atmosphere. And it creates jobs. And in fact, these jobs that are created are actually require the same skills that we need in our current oil and gas sector. They require the same type of businesses we already have. So the transfer is much easier. In terms of numbers, what we found was looking at almost 7,000 jobs being created between now and 2030. And yeah, like I said, the appeal is that you actually don't need retraining for these jobs. And they're not just jobs out in the field. There's actually jobs that can be created in the city. So this map here shows companies in Calgary that are working on reducing greenhouse gas emissions in the oil and gas sector. So those are clean tech jobs that can be created in the city. Just a little plug for this website here. This is the New Energy Economy, and it's a website that Pembina Institute created with a few partners, and it tracks successful and implemented projects in Alberta around those different sectors that I mentioned in the presentation. So if you have a project that's completed and not on this website, send us an email and we'll make sure we put it on there. So I want to conclude my presentation by stepping back a bit and talking about what actions do we need to take as a society if we want to create these jobs and create them in an accelerated manner in these growing sectors. And so that's looking at actions that need to be taken, not just at the municipal level, but at all levels of government. And there are some policy tools that are available here. These are just highlights. The actual suite of solutions is much bigger, but there's targets and goals that can be set. And the advantage of something like this, like a net zero target by 2050, is it sends a really strong signal to industry and investors to come to the province and invest in long-term projects and look at being here for decades. There's also many market-based tools available. So I think one thing probably on people's mind right now is carbon pricing, given the Supreme Court ruling from yesterday. So just to catch folks up who haven't seen this, it essentially concluded that the federal government could indeed set minimum national standards for pricing greenhouse gas emissions, and then province can decide how they're going to meet those standards. But the one example I actually want to use for market-based tools is something happening in Germany, where they are trying to transition away from coal and figure out how they can sort of kickstart a really clean energy economy. And one of the things they are doing is an auction for solar projects that include an electrolyzer to generate hydrogen. So that's an interesting way to get low cost projects that's funded by the government, but in a competitive manner. And that actually helps deploy a technology that hasn't been tested much. Another thing governments can do is direct investments. Obviously, transit is a really good example of that. And new technologies like hydrogen is another good example. And then there's programs. I already mentioned solar incentives. But the other kind of program is also on building human capital. So there are skills training programs that the governments can do and need to do to make sure that we have workers and job seekers who have the right skills that meet the demands of this new emerging economy. So there you have it, you know, like a huge suite of measures that need to be deployed. No magic bullet there, but we need to work closely with industry, with the finance sector, with educational institutions and stakeholders to be able to capture the job opportunities that can come from diversifying our economy and working towards a net zero economy. But with that, I'd like to open up the floor for questions and have some discussion with folks. So Dick, maybe I'll invite you back onto the screen.
Yes, thank you so much, Binnu. This was really, really great, and really appreciate your input here. I'm going to take a quick peek here at the questions and just push out the first one to you. I want to make sure you can hear me, right?
Yes, I can.
Okay, good stuff. So a first question here. Can you comment on emerging employment changes or opportunities in the agricultural sector of Alberta?
Ooh, really good question. Short answer is no. But I can do some speculation. I think you're right. And that is another sector that we did not capture here because it is a few degrees removed from the energy sector. But there is a lot changing there, and there is a lot of opportunity in the agriculture sector that connects to climate action. So one of the key pieces that's developing there is nature-based solutions. So that's how can farmers employ different tactics for managing their land in a way that actually helps sequester more carbon than current practices. So what I would hope is as governments and industry start investing more in these types of measures, it actually creates more employment opportunities in the agricultural sector.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Binnu, I also want to find out, what are the prospects for and what should new students, prospective students study? You've presented us with an array of possible opportunities. You know, there's a lot of ifs and buts, but we know it's a wave that's coming. What would you say about that? Where do the young people of today, what direction should they head into? And if you look at even people transitioning from one career to another, any comments on that, please?
Yeah, it's a very relevant question right now, especially as, you know, I know a lot of people have even gone back to school from employment during the pandemic. I would say maybe a couple of things. So with all the sectors I mentioned there are some specific programs you can take. So, you know, for example, for solar installation, if you are an electrician who used to work in the oil sands and you want to enter into the solar industry, there's not really too much extra training you need to take, but you just need to get more familiar with solar projects, but you can still apply some of your basic training to these industry. So there are specifics to each industry you can do. But I think one theme that's emerging is there's a need for folks that can navigate multiple different sectors and bring these different perspectives. So the joint degrees and programs that integrate, you know, environmental responsibility along with technical skills and business skills, I think will position job seekers and students to be able to navigate this new economy better. You know, there's going to be a lot of demand for entrepreneurs and new businesses, local businesses, like some of the energy efficiency and clean tech actions that need to be taken require an entrepreneurial spirit. So I think, yeah, degrees and training programs that combine multiple disciplines are going to be more and more effective, yeah, in terms of finding jobs.
Totally. You know, I think you perhaps had a few questions for the audience as well, and I was wondering if you wanted to throw that out there and we can monitor some responses. Would that work for you right now?
Yeah, for sure. I'm glad people didn't ask these tough questions of me yet. So I want to throw this to the audience. Inviting people to write comments on these in the chat box. To me, one of the tough things we need to figure out is with these new jobs that are coming up, how do we make sure that they're equitable and accessible? So the current energy industry in Alberta and across the world actually, you know, has certain biases. There isn't an equitable participation by women. There is an equitable participation by Indigenous people. Many of the solutions are still inaccessible for low-income households. So I would love to hear what folks have to say, particularly on the jobs, what we would need to do to make sure they're accessible to a wider range of population, and particularly those that are underrepresented right now. A long question, but yeah, keen to see what comes in.
So we invite you folks to perhaps put in there if you have any comments on what Binnu just asked there, any perspectives or any additional questions in that regard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sorry, Binnu.
Oh, I was thinking maybe while questions are rolling in, I could use this platform to highlight some folks who are working in this sector. So Women Building Futures is an organization. Unfortunately, I only learned about a few months ago, but they work out of Edmonton and serve industry across Alberta. And they're looking at seeing how they advise industries on how they can engage women better, retain women, particularly in trades. So they have an apprenticeship program and they stay with women workers when they get a job and keep getting feedback and provide mentorship as that happens. So there's like some real direct work that they're doing with industry and providing this consulting service. You know, so I see a demand for that growing, and I'd love to see those kind of services being offered also to the clean energy sector so that they start off on the right foot.
Totally. You know, while we move into that, I would like you to look at another question for us, please.
Sure.
You mentioned skill training. Mm-hmm. Do you know of the type of skills training or education that will be needed as we move into this new economy? What type of skills? It's very similar to what I asked earlier.
Yeah.
But is there any specific training or education that you could recommend, right? What skills are there? So it's associated with that previous question, but if you have any advice on that.
Yeah, you know, as we talk about this, there is the U.S. Department of Energy actually has a really good website that talks about what skills you can do depending, because it's so dependent on the type of career you want to take and which industry you want to enter into. So I'm gonna pop this in here and hopefully people can navigate it. I think this would be great for like the provincial or national government here in Canada to generate also. So there's like different career paths. It talks about what skills you need depending on which sector you want to apply to. So if I were to work backwards, so the jobs I mentioned in the oil and gas sector, there's really not much retraining you need to do there. So you just need to find the company that is working on those projects and apply for jobs there. And much of your existing oil and gas experience would apply to that. If you wanted to go more into renewables, then it's helpful to understand what that industry is like. So taking skills, and these trainings are sometimes offered by institutions like SATE and NATE. You don't even necessarily need to go to university for it, but you can take training to get certified to become a solar installer. And that's something you could do. I think some programs are even less than a year. It really depends on that. Energy efficiency is something similar. There's a lot of framers, electricians who have worked on building buildings, but then you just need that additional layer. So just like a few more courses on what energy efficiency technologies are out there and processes for that to access some of those jobs.
Good stuff. Thank you so very much. We've had a few questions on solar policy and so forth, but I'm going to come back to that. I want to jump to another question here. And the question is, from your perspective, what are the key policies or actions the Alberta government could take to turn these possibilities for employment and GHG emissions reduction into rapid action?
Great question. So I kind of go back to that slide, the last slide I shared there, but I think some of the key things the government can do is, like I said, it's so essential for the government to be able to send a long-term signal to industry. To create these jobs, what we need is we need to attract investments. So we need to attract dollars into the province, into the city. We need to attract businesses. And so they need to see long-term policy certainty. So one of the ways we can do that is by setting a net zero target in Alberta by 2050. There's no reason why we couldn't do that. And there's a lot of jurisdictions like Alberta that are starting to set that. And the carbon pricing is going to be a live debate in Alberta again. And I actually think there are many innovative solutions we can deploy in Alberta in how we design that carbon pricing. And we could do it in a way so the money comes back to impacted communities. There's money that comes back to retraining and reskilling for workers who are looking for jobs in these new sectors. The money could also come back to low-income households and be invested in some of the clean tech projects. So there's a lot around how we recycle the carbon pricing money that can drive job creation in these sectors. There's also direct investments the province can do. My subject area is electricity, so you'll see most of my examples will be from electricity. But like I said, with the German example, you know, there are still procurement programs that could be run that competitively get. We may not need it for something like wind and solar that are now established technologies, but for something like hydrogen electrolyzers, those could be competitively procured. And yeah, I mean, to your question on solar incentives, that's something right now some cities have, but that's something that could also be rolled out provincially. And many progressive jurisdictions across the world actually have investments, not just in large wind farms, but also incentives for rooftop solar so that average everyday citizens can participate. Maybe last one thing, in case you haven't heard it in another presentation, is also for zero emission vehicles. So I know it's a bit of a difficult topic for Alberta, but at the end of the day, you are starting to see people have interest in electric vehicles. Like in Alberta, I think 56% of Albertans said that they want their next car to be an EV. So something like that, the province can set direction by asking dealerships and manufacturers we don't have a manufacturing in Alberta yet, but in dealerships to say that they should have a certain percentage of electric vehicles so that Albertans can access those cars. And when you get that, then you can start building EV infrastructure and create jobs. So yeah, I think There's a lot the Alberta government could do, and this is the right time to start doing it as we do plan for COVID recovery.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that. I'm going to give you a bit of feedback from a few of our participants on your question. So one participant said, I think one key is to encourage entrepreneurs, partially through financing, from diverse communities specifically. I think that's a great one. Any comments? Have you seen that before?
So we actually just recently had a conversation between some folks from Germany and the Prairie provinces in Canada, and they were saying, thank you for picking that up, that one of the things they need to invest in is in entrepreneurs to get them over the valley of death. So they have some cool ideas, but there's a lot of reasons they die. And you're right, exactly. Financing is one of them. So being able to put forward affordable, low rate loans out for these kind of entrepreneurs is a big, big piece of what we can do. And I'd say maybe another part of that is also featuring these entrepreneurs from these underrepresented communities, you know, just creating more role models to showcasing them as these are folks that are contributing to the economy.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Some good points that are being made here. Another one is direct targeted advertising and education to less represented potential workers. That's similar to the push to attract women to STEM jobs. It's excellent. And I think we've seen plenty of these examples in the past. I think it's just being more overt about the actual targeted group and create that path, because sometimes we just focus on one aspect of that path. And what we don't realize, as research has shown, there is that valley of death somewhere in between. And we need to create the whole path and allow people to walk through that to the very end. So very important. And another one that's connected to the other two is really being very specific, where the attendant is saying, or the participant here is saying, Lakeland and Nate have 2-year diplomas focused on energy efficiency and renewable electricity and buildings. Fantastic. So I'm not sure if Sate has the same. I don't know if there's any
attendees similar. Yeah, ask the attendees to folks know about the Sate program.
If any attendees know if Sate has the same type of diploma, I'm not sure of that.
If I can pick up on the targeted advertising, I think there's different ways to do that too. So not just in our advertising, but also in our procurement policy. So with the clean energy, like I said, some of the actions the government can take is actually procure clean energy and put competitive bids out there to get these projects. Those procurement policies could have requirements for representation from these underrepresented groups. So you could have allocations for projects from Indigenous communities. You could have policies that require gender equity among the contractors and subcontractors that are applying for these bids. So just as an example, the renewable electricity procurement program that the Alberta government ran a couple of years ago, one of the rounds actually asked for Indigenous participation. And in that round, the project that won was actually at slightly lower cost than the average cost for the other projects. You know, so there's a lot of myth busting also happening here. You know, a lot of people think that First Nations projects are more expensive and complex. They are complex, but they are able to compete with non-First Nations projects too.
Thank you, Binnu. That's really great. Let me see what else we have here. I think you've answered most of our questions. anything else that you would like to add for us today, on this subject? Any next steps that you believe we should take? If you could summarize that as, here's probably our big moves for 2021. We are in 2021, right? I keep on forgetting that we had 2020 as well, but we're in 2021. Any big moves that you, from your perspective, would say we should take as a broader community to advance this? What would you say?
Oof, yeah, big question there. I'd say the first step is creating this kind of dialogue. So kudos to the City of Calgary for creating this kind of platform. We need to be able to bring together diverse voices. Like you're seeing the solutions folks are sharing on the screen here. We need to bring those voices together to be able to create an aspirational vision for what the city could be. And I know we've done this previously on at different scales and scopes. Right now, we're looking at something that is addressing the existential crisis that humanity is facing, you know? So, creating an inspirational vision for the role that the city can play. The city has so many tools at its disposal, so many amazing entrepreneurs and caring, intelligent residents here in the city, and amazing businesses that are doing so many creative things. So, like, I think creating that dialogue around what role, what is that vision for Calgary in this emerging economy, and then thinking about what are the systemic issues we want to take on and challenges we can address together. But I think that sort of convening could be really powerful in connecting the right people with each other. The other thing I would say also is this question of finance. It always comes up. And so when we are going big like this, we need folks that are backing us up, right? So having industry at the table is really important. Having the finance sector. So, you know, we have the Alberta Treasury Bank, we have service, we have pretty creative financial institutions actually in Alberta. So having them at the table and creating creative financial solutions that can help the city move forward, I think would be part of it. So yeah, I'd just say, sorry, not to say just more new dialogue, but I think dialogue that goes towards creating that vision and then roles that different organizations can play.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so very much. I'm just going to check with Adrian if she sees anything else here. Adrian, do you see anything else? Nothing. So I
Oh, sorry,
believe.
Dick. I
Go
did see
ahead.
a couple of questions that were wanting to know sort of if we were going to be offering incentives around green roofs or solar rooftops. So I did put some information to learn about both of those programs with the city. But if you had anything more to add about that.
No, I did see that, and thank you for adding to that. We've got a wealth of information on our city website as well, and I'm sure, Binnu, you guys have the same with Pembina. So we would invite you to please take a look at those links at the and Adrian's actually posted the link to the Pembina organization, as well as links to the City of Calgary's website where you can find more information on solar installation. Policy advantages, as well as some of our permitting systems for solar. So you'll be able to get a little bit more information there as well.
Dick, if I might use just this
Please.
minute to add something to your last question.
Yes.
As you talked about this policy, it just highlighted for me also when you said, what is something tangible we can do? Because with the COVID recovery, you're actually seeing an unusual amount of government action and participation in the shaping of the
Yes.
economy. I actually think it creates a lot of space for people to participate actively. So I'm sure City of Calgary is also looking at, you know, a lot of engagement from people, but I would just say, you know, I would really encourage participants. I mean, thank you for coming to this session, but you know, engage with the other forums that the city is putting out there to get input from citizens, and similarly engage with the provincial government, engage with the federal government. There are massive policies that are being designed right now that are gonna set the pathway for what our future looks like 20 to 30 years from now. Investments we make right now are going to determine our future for the next decades. And you know, when you're asking questions about what courses students should take, their future is decided by these decisions that are being made this year. So I would really encourage people to participate in processes at all three levels of government.
That is wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I mean, you know, this is a conversation that has been happening throughout the last 2 days. It is about lowering our emissions. It is about looking at our technologies. But at the end, it also helps us with our jobs, creating more jobs. And I think you've pointed out a few important points here, and that is about equity in society. We are a society where we take care of each other, we take care of our neighbors. And if we are unable to do that as part of our recovery, I think we are losing a lot in the process. I think we have been given a chance here to do so much more, not just, I always say, I'm not just doing this for the future, I'm doing this for today as well. And I think that's really critical for us. So Binnu, on that note, I would really like to thank you for sharing your insights and spending your time with us today. Thank you as well for joining us, everybody on this presentation. And be sure to visit calgary.ca/climate symposium to register for some other sessions. I think there might be one or two left today. And don't forget about the side events that's also happening over this weekend. We've got Earth Hour coming up on Saturday. So there's quite a few things happening. Please take a look at that. To learn more about our actions you can take to help limit climate change and prepare for a changing climate, you can visit calgary.ca/climate action. My apologies. We'll be sending out a short survey. There's a link to it in the chat too, and we would appreciate your feedback about this session. Thanks again for taking the time to join us today. And hope you have a great Friday and a great weekend. Apparently, the sun is out in Calgary. Take care, folks.
Great. Thanks, everyone. Take care.
Bye-bye.